set.
Thank you.
It's cold, but it's January. What do you expect? So, you know, that's the way it is. We've got some announcements here for you. There is, in the back, there are green flyers and yellow, or green papers and yellow papers. And you can take all of you want. But the yellow is the church calendar for the year, okay? We sat down after the congregational meeting last week and worked through a few things. I will tell you there are not a huge amount of activities on here because we didn't put a huge amount because, you know, the last 2 years you plan an activity and then you cancel an activity and then you plan an activity. So there aren't just the big things, the meals, the Lenten studies, the Easter. Something we decided to do on the June 5th. We will have our five-year cemetery association and a celebration of the 145th anniversary of the congregation. And we're not planning on anything massive for that one, but to put it out there for people to understand that we've been here for 145 years. And then in October, the first Sunday of October, October 2nd, the 100th anniversary of the church building. This building will be, I looked back, and it was dedicated in October, and that fell right into... It was destroyed in June. They decided to rebuild in September, and they dedicated in October. So it went pretty fast once they decided. But we thought we would put that in with the first Sunday of October, which is the Missions Festival, and kind of focus on that, and that's when we take off our stuff. And for some reason, everybody's looking up. I think it's pretty solid yet. But it's actually, I will say, I think we take pretty good care of the property because I don't think the building looks 100 years old. But it will be 100 years old. Why they did that beadboard up there, I don't know, but it is unique.
That's what they put in. That's what they put in for ceilings.
Yes, that's what they put. And we were told one time when someone painted this church that we were extremely lucky that no one ever painted that ceiling. Mm-hmm. Oh. That it went out of style in the 60s and everybody painted it white. And that was probably just too high, so they didn't. But it is one of the more unique features of the church, is the hardwood ceiling, the beadboard ceiling. So, and I've always thought it was pretty too. That's just the way it is. So, those are back there, okay? There is one mistake on it. I can't do anything without having a mistake. So, but on February, there's a worship Sunday school and worship on the 16th and the 20th. No, it's on the
one of them.
Yeah, You'll look, okay?
It's on Sundays.
It's on the Sundays, yeah. Let's just leave it at that. I always point that out because we are having Ash Wednesday services this year, but Ash Wednesday starts March, I think it's 2nd.
Yes.
I have to look. But Easter is late this year. So, because usually we have to take one of our Lenten studies because of the human being dinner and so forth, but that will all be passed before we get too deep into Lent and things this year. So, now those are all on there. Speaking of Hammond Bean Dinner, letters went out this week. Thank you, Rosemary, and whoever else helped her. Here are flyers for it, and these are the green sheets back there. Okay? We decided on a price. I texted George and a couple other people. We couldn't remember what we charged. George looked it up. We charged $7 last time. Went with $7.50. Okay, yes, there's quarters involved, but most people who come are probably couples, and so it's going to be $15 together. So we did up the price slightly. But that is coming up. It will be February 20th, so take a flyer, hand it to somebody, hang it up, do whatever you want. We can always make more. We'll get it out on the social media network and into the papers and so forth, too. Okay? I will also tell you this, and this is no decision. Keep this in mind. There was no decision on this, but the church council did discuss, is it time to do away with maybe the chili and stew or the ham and bean, one or the other, or move one to the other date? Because when I first started, Rosemary was the president, and we were financially hurting.
Yes.
We were financially hurting. And so we started the ham and bean dinner to try to make some funds. In the first couple of years, it did okay, and then one year they were calling for snow and we didn't think we'd have anybody, and we had a doorbuster. And from there on, we've sold out or whatever, but just the thought that the chili and stew supper used to be the Women's Fellowship fundraiser. And when they didn't have the Women's Fellowship anymore, then it became the churches. But it is awfully close to the sausage supper. So we're turning around doing that. So do we have both? Do we keep both? Do we move chili and stew to ham and bean date? Or do we just not use chili and stew? I don't know. But just share your feelings with some of your council members so that when it comes time to make a decision, we won't make a decision until next fall anyway. Do we need three meals? Kind of thing. The only thing I will say is the date on the chili and stew has always bothered me because I did the letters sometimes, and it's like just a month ago we were sending out for sausage supper, and then here we're sending out for the next one again, too. So just FYI, that's been discussed, so just share with different people your feelings on that and what you think we should do, okay? Because we do make money on both of them, but we are hopefully past hard financial times at this point. Other announcements. I need this thing back. Even though there's a mistake on it. The first Lenten study will be on March 6th. Okay? And the church council decided to do this. We will have 5 Lenten studies. And we will have Ash Wednesday services this year on the 2nd, which is a Wednesday night. Okay? So that's a different thing for us. But we did one before the pandemic, and it wasn't hugely attended, but it was a very nice service, and I enjoyed doing it and enjoyed it. It was a great opening to the Lent season, and so we are going to do that again. But the 6th, the 13th, the 20th, the 27th, and April 3rd are the 5 Sundays that we will do Lenten studies after church. We will be studying Witnesses to the Cross. It's the book, and it's by the same author that Amy Jo Levine, who we have done some things in the past. She was the lady who was raised Jewish and is now a Christian divinity scholar at Vanderbilt. And so it's the view from Simon of Cyrene, and I think Mary is in there, because last year we did the Women of the Cross, and some the different people who were standing that were involved with the Jesus carrying the cross and at the crucifixion. So I think it'll be a great study. There's a little video piece that goes with it that's about 12 minutes long, and then there's the study. But this is what's important for us. The church council decided that we would do, rather than poor Judy wherever she went. Oh, she's back here today. It's good to mix it up once in a while. Be in charge of food every time, that we would do a sign-up sheet, and that the church council would give the first person $50, and then they could buy the supplies. It wouldn't be out any money that way. And then we would all contribute like we have, and then that money just rolls to the next person. So if, just we're gonna say, if the Lenekes took this one, that the end of that meal, if Rosemary and Julie took this one, I'm not volunteering you, I'm just picking, you know, then they would just hand that money, and whoever gets it at the end hands the money back to Renee. And so we did that in one other organization I was involved in, and it worked pretty well that way. And also it kept anybody from being out of pocket money, kind of thing. And it also kept Bernita from having to write a check to everybody every week. You know, you just do it for a month. So this will be in the back too if you're interested in hosting the meal. The only thing I would ask is if you would kind of just semi-coordinate with the person next to you, or if you're down here above, and that we don't have the same meal in 2 weeks in a row. Okay? Now, I think we could have soup too, because there's all kinds of soup, but I'm like, if we did breakfast 2 weeks in a row or something, I don't know. Just there's all kinds of ideas out there. So, yeah?
I'm thinking if we watch what we do with our leftovers from not having any dinner, we can pretty well cover that.
I think we're probably right. And just put it on there, though, just in case, because last year we sold out. So we had planned to do a meal, and
we got it.
Yeah, so that first one we could maybe just cross through and see, and then if we need it, we can always have it, because we have time this year.
You would risk my cooking?
I would risk your cooking. I would risk you purchasing something. And it's not saying that one person has to be involved, and I'm just looking, but say Bill and Chris and Bev wanted to do it together, or Bev and Bernita wanted to do it. It's just a matter of calling each other and saying, okay, I'll do this. I'm just saying, I'll do the spaghetti and the salad, and we'll fix the drinks when we get there, or something like that. You know, it's just some coordination. That way one person's not in trouble having to do it every week, because as much as she may have enjoyed it, it gets old after a while. I know that. So. Oh no, you did a good job. We were thinking of you. We were trying to keep you from being saddled every week. Yeah, we thought we could share and have some other people, but don't worry, we'll work it all out. So, anything else that I have forgotten at this point? Next Sunday is a fifth Sunday, eat lunch together, and we can talk about that next Sunday. And that is totally at your comfort level. If you want to go, you go. If you don't, you don't. So I don't know where we want to go. Does Las Brisas sound like a decent place? They usually are pretty good with the tables and the crowds, so I thought maybe that would be a good one. Besides the last time we ate there, like half the church was there anyway. But we may try to get a head count a little bit and then give them a call right before services or something, and kind of let them know. But that is totally, like I said, at your comfort level. If you're comfortable eating out with people and things, that's fine. If you're not, that's fine too. Nobody's going to say a word. Stand with me for the call of worship. This is adapted from Psalm 27. Wait for the Lord. Be strong and let your heart take courage.
The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear?
Wait for the Lord, be strong, and let your heart take courage.
The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Whom shall I be afraid?
Wait for the Lord, be strong, and let your heart take courage.
We come in hope of seeing God's goodness in the land of liberty. We will wait for the Lord.
You bow your heads, please, for the invocation. O God, our light and our sight of salvation, shelter us in your love. O God, our stronghold, protect us from danger. We come with shouts of joy to worship you this day. We come with songs to celebrate your love. We come with longing to seek your presence. Be with us now, O God, as we sing your praises and offer our prayers to you in the name of Christ our Lord. Amen. You'd open your hymnals to 354. You may not know this by name, but you will know the tune. I guarantee you that.
Peace of all eternity. could love me in my shamefulness, why he should die to draw my soul to him. But this I know, that Christ the Lord is risen, and praise his name.
And if you listen to those words, I picked that song specifically because it's a great transition from Epiphany into Ordinary or On the Lent, because it starts with at the end of the first verse, was in love was born a child for me that holy night, and then ends with the rising of Jesus. So it's just kind of a neat song. So that's that, more than you ever wanted to know. As we go to God with our concerns this morning, there's some I want to mention. Anna Maurice and Paul's son, Brian Berler, had a heart attack this week. He's in North Carolina, isn't it?
South Carolina.
No,
he's in Virginia.
Virginia, okay. Well, we were all wrong. he's on the East Coast. He's in Virginia. He had to have 3 bypasses. They were only able to do 2. But he had to wait for a while because there was a nursing shortage and they didn't have people to do that. So he did have surgery Friday, wasn't it? And he came through surgery, and he's just in pain right now and working through all the struggles after surgery. So we pray that he does well with that. Mary Kutcher called me last night. She is sick herself. She's got a lot of chest congestion and so forth, and so she needs to get past that. She's been struggling with that for a while. But her oldest brother, Jim Taylor, passed away yesterday. And I have said in the past that Mary's maiden name was Dickerson. That's not Mary's maiden name. It's Taylor. But she's interrelated to the Dickersons. One of her sisters is Mary Terry Dickerson, which is Daniel Dickerson that was on the foot, and Grice that were on Jackson's football team, and all that. Those are Mary's great nephews. So they live behind us. So that's how I know that. But it's Jim Taylor. Lucas kind of turned a corner this week. He's doing quite a bit better. They don't know why, but he all of a sudden he's walking up and down the steps by himself, and he may get to go back to school. Quicker than they thought. He is going to be released early, anybody that's ever worked in a school, but he will be released early so that he's not in the hall to be bumped and so forth, and someone will have to carry his backpack and things like that. But that's pretty ordinary. I used to love when I was a middle school principal and people would come in with a child with a broken leg and they'd want to explain everything, and you didn't want to be rude, but you're like, there's 700 kids here. There's like 3 with a broken leg at any given point, you know, so it's just, we can handle this. But right now they are watching the wound site though, because the color of the heel is not what they're wanting it to be. So they hope they don't have to go back in and do some other surgery on that. Ryan explained it all. He's a, you know, like nurse practitioner kind of thing, and I didn't understand. It's too white, basically. They want it to be they want it to be a bruised color at this point, because that means the blood is flowing well into that area. And so scars often turn white afterwards, but while it's healing, they need it to be bad. But the bar is still in place. It is slipped a little bit, but his pain level has went down, and he's moving around some. And like I said, he's walking up and down steps to his bedroom by himself now, and not holding a pillow and all that kind of stuff. So hopefully that's good news. Anyone else?
Very good friends of ours, Howard Sudemeyer. Had a seizure last week. Was on the stairs when it happened. So he fell, broke his shoulder, bit his tongue. He was on blood thinners, so they had a hard time getting the bleeding to stop. Once he got to the hospital, he had another seizure. He's still in the hospital, but he's doing better. So his wife called me and asked for prayers. So.
Okay. Howard Sudemeyer.
Sudemeyer.
Yeah. Sudemeyer, okay. Anyone else? Susan?
My cousin's son, who is 43 years old, was just diagnosed with T-cell lymphoma, stage 3. So they're trying to determine treatment right now.
And as I'm looking, good to see Linda back.
Yeah.
Good to see Linda back, and her blood pressure is a little bit better under control and so forth.
144/66, which is great.
Yeah, good. We'll take that over the 200 and some. Other people? Gary? Good to see Gary here. Larry?
I have another cousin passed away this week. Dan, if anyone knew Danny, when he went to school here, he was in Pennsylvania, and I don't know any real details. I just got a call a couple days ago that he passed away. So.
Danny Taylor?
Yeah.
Okay. My dad went to the orthopedic surgeon Tuesday, and he can put 50% weight now on his leg, which means that he can put his toes in like half his foot. So the physical therapist comes to their house and is working on that. He and mom were able to get to the hematologist on Thursday, and which kind of started all this problem with his hip falling and breaking his hip, is because his hemoglobin was so low and he passed out. So they were able to get him his shots, and so hopefully week from Tuesday, he will be full weight bearing, so he'll just have to walk with a walker. So continue to pray that is exactly what happens.
Lydia?
My trip to New Orleans was really good.
Her trip to New Orleans was really good. So.
Janice, Uncle Ronnie Martin is in a regular room now.
Oh,
I see you.
Very good.
And I'm going to transfer him to St. Louis for rehab.
Good. I forgot to ask about that. And Tom, any news on Tom?
Yeah, he's doing all right.
Doing all right? Because I knew he had another blood clot in his legs.
Yeah.
Okay. Anyone else? Good stuff. Some of you got some vacation time this week.
I went back to full school.
She went back to full school, yeah. We went back to full school, but all these people are running to me saying, I need a placement here, I need a placement here. And I'm like, good luck with that. The schools are all closed. Can't do anything while the schools are closed. But, you know, God works in mysterious ways. And we're going to talk about the providence of God. But maybe the cold weather and all that kind of just hit at the right time. And I remember having a conversation with Chris Glick about shutting the schools down for flu. And it doesn't do any good, really, because people just send them to someplace else for babysitting, and they all get together and they do all this. What we need is, some of you are going to hate me for this, but we need about a week of really cold temperatures and about 8 to 10 inches of snow where everybody just stays home for a while. It may not be the best for everybody, but I think it would go a long way with some health issues. Whether it's COVID or flu or cold and just stomach bug or whatever, that sometimes just keeps people away. You know,
we get 8 inches of snow, your ears gonna be burning while I'm sleeping.
They're hot already. And I will see be saying prayers for the words coming out your mouth. Anybody else have anything to
give us some warning on that, and he and I can head to Florida or
something. Okay, yeah. Well, I just have to say, we were talking at work the other day how they've called a couple times and it's going to be bad, and we've had nothing, and now people are going to get used to it, and sometimes they're going to say, oh, it won't be much, and poof, you know. I still remember going to bed the night that we had been at Joan Florence Curry's, if anybody knew them, they lived over where the Daniels live right now, the night, and they were playing aggravation, and I was laying on the couch watching TV, and they called for maybe a half inch to an inch of snow, and the next morning, my mom woke me up and said, "You've got to see this." It was thundering and lightning, and it was already, 79, and it was already 23 or 24 inches on the ground, so. Anybody else? Let's go to bed. Let's go to God's prayer. You can bet this out. Well, it's hard to pray after that. Father, we come to you this morning seeking rest, knowing that our rest does come in you, and then sometimes things slip and we say things and that maybe we do all need to take a nap. Maybe that's something that you need to assist us with. Take away our anxieties and our fears and just let us relax and know that your providence is around us, that you're taking care of things. We also pray for those that we mentioned that are in need of healing, that needs for special medical care and all those kinds of things, that we can that can be provided for them and that their healing can take place. We pray for all those who are worried and concerned and anxious about things. Let them be able to deal with their anxieties and the different things that bother people, and sometimes that's worse than being physically sick. And Father, we come today knowing that we are a congregation of people who are willing to take on the task that you give us, willing to do things and willing to do whatever your will is. And we ask that you continue to show us your will and that you continue to let this congregation grow and be part of your world. Father, we also come knowing that we're a sinful people and that sometimes words do slip out of our mouth. And sometimes we allow them to slip out of our mouth, and that we all are sinful in one way or another. And that you let your Son, Jesus Christ, go to that cross and die so that we could be forgiven of our sins, and one great sacrifice would take care of everything forever. And we formally announce that, or ask for your forgiveness right now. We ask all these things in the prayer you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
We're going to skip the children's sermons because I forgot totally about it.
Are we going to have children's church?
I'm going to stay here this morning.
We can go to children's
church. She's going to have children's church, so. Okay. Well, that took care of that then. So teach over there. How's that? If you would open your hymnals then to 358. I'm going to sing a great doge for him because he lives. Stand or sit?
Sit.
Stand. Do whichever way you want. I'm flexible. You want to sit, sit. You want to stand, stand. I honestly don't know how you can sit singing because he lives, but or if you want to stand part of the way and sit down, that's fine too.
We might fall asleep though.
Thank you.
So the scriptures today are, of course, all 10 verses of Esther. If you haven't read that yet, I would encourage you to read the book of Esther. It's not that long of a read, and it's a good read. But today it comes from chapter 3, verses 12 through 14. Even though that's, or through 15 actually, it's actually a pretty long section, even though it's only 3 verses. Then Haman, remember Haman, bad guy, said to King Xerxes, "There is a certain people dispersed among the peoples in all provinces of your kingdom who keep themselves separate. Their customs are different from those of all other people, and they do not obey the king's laws. It is not the king's best interest to tolerate them. If it pleases the king, let a decree be issued to destroy them, and I will give 1,000 talents of silver to the king's administrators for the royal treasury." Remember, that was close to $1 million. Remember why Haman wasn't, if you weren't here, I'm just going to review a little, why Haman was not happy. It's because Mordecai had been honored, or Mordecai refused, Haman was honored, and was part of the prince's palace, and was everyone was supposed to bow to Haman, and Mordecai refused. Esther's uncle, or Esther's first cousin, I'm sorry, there's some debate on that actually, but Esther's first cousin, and he refused. So the king took his signet ring from his finger and gave it to Haman, son of Amedatha, the Agite. And if you remember, the Agite piece was very important because it goes back to Haman was from the tribe of the Agites, and that, the son of King Agag and all of that, and that the Agites and the Amalekites, remember me trying to pronounce those all last week? The Amalekites and the Jews hated each other from the time they escaped Egypt, basically. So this is a long-standing Hatfields and McCoy kind of situation. He took his signet ring and gave it to Haman and said, "Keep the money and do with the people as you please. Don't bother me." Okay? Now that sounds really cold of the king, but you got to realize he had a huge, huge empire. Okay, the British Empire right now we see as a huge world empire. It was tiny. It is tiny compared to the amount of land and cities that Persia help. Okay. Then on the 13th day of the first month, the royal secretaries were summoned. They wrote out in the script for each province and in the language of each people. So they made, Haman was making sure everybody was going to follow this for every province and every language, because he was, remember, he tried to control Greece and things like that. He already controlled a lot of the Mediterranean, a lot of different languages there. So he made sure it was done in the correct, to each province and in the correct language for that province. To the king's satraps, the governors of the various provinces, and the nobles of the various peoples. These were written in the name of King Xerxes himself and sealed with his own ring. And sometimes I wonder if Xerxes really realized what was going on behind his back. Okay, but he did give Haman the ring, so it's his fault. Dispatches were sent by couriers to all the king's provinces with the order to destroy, kill, and annihilate all the Jews, young and old, men and women, and children, on the single day, the 13th day of the 12th month of the month of Adar, and to plunder their goods. A copy of the text of the edict was issued as law in every province and made known to the people of every nationality so that they would be ready for that day. The couriers went out, spurred on by the king's command. The edict was issued in the citadel of Susa. The king and Haman sat down to drink, but the city of Susa was bewildered. I want you to that last verse 15, and the edict was issued in the city of Susa, And the king and Haman sat down and had their drink and relaxed. And so, but the city, it includes the city of Susa, was bewildered. And it was bewildered because no one understood why. These people had been living with us peacefully all the way through. Why all of a sudden are we annihilating them? But you didn't go against the king's orders either. It was basically genocide. And genocide is an ugly word. Okay? Genocide is the deliberate killing of people who belong to a particular racial, political, or cultural group. And so we often think of Nazi Germany, of Bosnia, of Victoria. I don't know if you have any family in that area, but the Bosnia.
No, but it's close.
It's close. It's close to where you live. Bosnia, the Cambodian genocide. So I did some research. Since 1755, there have been 42 recognized attempts at genocide. 42 times other people have tried to wipe other people out. And this one might surprise you. One of the most notable was in California in 1846 through 1873, when there was an estimated 120,000 Armenians killed because of their race. You ever heard that piece? You know what an Armenian is? I had to look it up. It's an old word for Native American. Now you think of the Old West. They killed roughly 120,000 Native American Indians to take their land. Okay? And I'm not trying to preach any kind of thing here. I had not really thought of it that way. And if you watch Dances with Wolves and those kind of, yeah, they do. But okay, and these are just a few examples throughout history, because Lord knows this has went on for a long time, okay? If you remember from last week, Haman was of the Agag tribe, and he managed to get Xerxes to do all this kind of stuff that we just read about. And then we get to Esther chapter 4, 1 through 3. And this is where some of the, it gets kind of interesting. When Mordecai learned of all this that had been done, he tore his clothes, put on sackcloth and ashes, and went out into the city, wailing loudly and bitterly. Okay? I've never seen anybody wail at a funeral. But my cousin married someone who was from Pennsylvania and very Italian. And wailing is a custom. And when some of her husband's family died, she was telling us how she reacted to they would wail. Oh, where am I? And they wail. And then they'd stop and they'd all talk, and somebody new would come in and they'd all wail together again. And then they'd stop and they'd talk. It's just wailing was a long custom, okay? But he went only as far as the king's gate because no one clothed in sackcloth was allowed to enter. In every province to which the edict and the order of the king came, there was great mourning among the Jews with fasting, weeping, and wailing. Many lay in sackcloth and ashes. Now we've often heard of sackcloth and ashes. I didn't know exactly what sackcloth was, so I looked it up. Okay? Burlap is what they say it's similar to, but it was actually made out of black goat hair. So it was very coarse, and it was very uncomfortable to wear. So if you ever had a wool, full wool sweater on with nothing on underneath, full wool sweaters are incredibly warm, but you gotta wear something underneath it because it'll just irritate you to death. Okay? And the ashes are significant for desolation and ruin and repentance and just a sign of your humility. And we still use ashes. That's why we have National Wednesday service. You know, they're still thought of that way. News of the decree devastated Mordecai. And according to the scriptures, like I said, it bewildered the city of Susa. Okay. And that line tells me that nobody saw this coming. Most people didn't have a problem with the Jews. Why all of a sudden are we going to kill them all? Okay? And it was one man with a goal that he wanted at all costs, and that was Haman. Okay? So Mordecai turns to the only hope they have, and that's Queen Esther. And keep in mind, Mordecai and Esther have yet to reveal that she's Jewish. Now, I also want you to realize this was not the reason that Esther was put forth as a candidate for the queen. Okay? Sometimes we forget that. None of this happened until she became queen. So it's not like Mordecai saw this coming and said, if we can get Esther in there, maybe we can get something done about, you know, the political moves of all this. That was not the case. She became queen. And then the decree went out to kill all the Jews. Okay? And that's what the providence of God is about. The providence of God is about God working through things for us and around us. Okay? Mordecai begged Esther and even said, and this is a great line, perhaps this was the moment for which you were created. It's a pretty powerful line. Okay? He begged Esther to use your influence on the king and try to overturn the edict. And Esther's response is in chapter 5, verse 11. All the king's officials and all the people of the royal provinces know that for any man or woman who approaches the king in the inner court without being summoned, the king, without being summoned by the king, has but one law. So if you came into the court to the king without being summoned, there was one law that played, that they be put to death, unless the king extends the golden scepter to them and spares their lives. And Esther knew this. And Mordecai said, you got to go to the king. And Esther says, but it's been 30 days since he even called on me. I haven't seen him in 30 days. Right? Esther suddenly became the king, or the key to all of this. Can you imagine the pressure? Can you imagine the fear? My whole race depends on me? Pretty big rock on your shoulder. You're a big stone around your neck. Right? And she's even saying, maybe I'm not in the best favor with the king right now because it's been 30 days since I've seen the guy. Right? And you got to remember that, you know, there was this harem of wives, of which Esther was the queen, but there was also this harem of concubines on the other side of the palace, so we don't know what all is going on here. And Esther also had to probably think about Vashti. He's already got rid of one wife. He could do the same. Okay? It's a fine and good thing to talk about being a hero. It's a different thing to actually be a hero. Okay? So it's one thing to talk about, I'll be a hero. But it's another thing when you're actually a hero. Because most heroes don't even realize they're doing it when they become a hero. Mordecai hits Esther right between the eyes with the next piece of scripture, though. And remember, Mordecai was her father figure, even though it was her cousin. Do not think that because you are in the king's house, that you alone of all the Jews will escape. If you remain silent at this time, relief and deliverance for the Jews will arise from another place, but you and your father's family will perish. Mordecai says, don't think that because you're the queen, when he finds out you're Jewish, he won't kill you too. The edict says all. And the king's going to look like a fool if he doesn't take you out with us. He can't do it. He's going to take you out too. That had to be a little bit of a hard conversation. Okay? If you've ever been in those hard conversations, sometimes those aren't fun. Okay? Had to have several over my life, all of my life, but you know, and I find it interesting that Mordecai thought this through pretty good because he pulled out the big guns. He pulled out the family. Okay? Because he pulls out your father's family will perish. And in the Jewish community, family is a huge piece. Okay? But it also reminds me a little bit of the Jeff Foxworthy story. And Jeff Foxworthy talks about how when you're first married, you argue a little, and then, you know, as you go along a little, you argue a little bit more, and then at some point, you actually drag in the family. So when you say the thing, well, like you're just like your mother, that is like throwing a match onto the gasoline can, you know what I mean? So, but it works the other way too, is your dad sure would be disappointed, okay? So he's throwing that on there too. So you have all that family guilt. He's throwing that on there. And keep in mind, her family dynamic was, she had Mordecai. That was it, okay? There's never any mention of any other family other than Mordecai, a cousin who raised her. So that also tells me she didn't have a lot of aunts and uncles or anybody else, because why would a cousin be raising you if there were not anybody else, okay? Jewish historians do believe that Esther and Mordecai were first cousins, although some debate that it was her uncle. So I will throw that out there to you. Then Mordecai throws in the most interesting spiritual call to courage that I think is in the Bible. And he says, and who knows but that you have come to your royal position for such a time as this. But who knows that you have come to your royal position for such a time as this? And that is a, if you think about it, that is a very deeply spiritual question. You can think about that in everything you do in your life. Who knows that if I was put here for this one moment, why was I here? In life, we don't get free passes. Not even the Queen of Persia. Right? Providence. I told you we're going to talk about providence. Providence is that divine guidance right here. Okay? That's that God working around you through other people, through circumstances, taking care of you, even though you may not ever understand it until it's much too late. The entire book of Esther, if you recall, never mentions God. Never mentions God's name, never mentions God. But there's very strong theme running through the book of Esther, and that's that theme of providence. Because God put Esther in the right place, through the right circumstances, with the right people, to assure something didn't happen. What's he doing for us? How do we know when our moment is here? How do we know we haven't messed up our moment? How do we know we haven't passed our moment? How do we know our moment hasn't yet to come? When is our moment? Okay? And you know what? Don't ever let anybody tell you Christianity is a yellow brick road that you're going to go skipping down. Okay? Which I always thought that was kind of funny, because if you really look at the Wizard of Oz, the yellow brick road went into a picnic. There's flying monkeys and trees that beat them up and everything that poppy could. But same way, we're going to have trials and troubles. John 14:33 says, I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart. I have overcome the world. And Isaiah 42:2 says, when you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And when you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep you away. When you walk through the fire, you will be trusted. The flames will not set you ablaze. The Bible never says that we won't have trials and tribulations. Jesus promises to get us through them. Okay? And that's one of the things, if you talk to someone who's not a big believer, or who wants to dismiss things and everything, will say, well, he's never done anything for me. Da 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 da. Well, you hit him with that providence piece. Well, how do you know? You ever had anything turn out right afterwards? Once you saw it from the other side, it's the way it was supposed to be. I didn't like it at the time, but I know now that's the way it was best. Okay? And I'll just say something. I was talking to somebody the other day on the phone, and it's one of my supervisors, and her mother has Alzheimer's really bad. And they're struggling with the getting in to see her and all those kinds of things because they're trying to protect. And I said, as much as I hate to say it, I have thought that I'm glad my mom was already gone by the time this hit. Because we didn't have to struggle with that piece. We did a little with Pam's dad in the hospital, but it was just for a little bit of time. But we didn't have to struggle with that piece of things. So that's the way it was supposed to work out. This is a quote, and I have no idea who said it, but we live in a beautiful but broken world. However, our Creator made this world and did not destine it or us for brokenness. He destined us for a wonderful life. His intentions for us are good. He cares for us so much that he became one of us. He took on our brokenness even to the point of death. His death gave birth to our life, eternal life. He arose from the dead and is recreating our world and invites us all to be a part of it. One day we will restore the world to its intended beauty and reclaim his family, and we will live with him forever. It's all going to work out. The providence of God is there. And the providence of God with Mordecai saying to Esther, who knows, but this is the moment you may have been created for. May have taken Esther from, if I go to the king, I will perish, to the decision is, I will go to the king, and if I perish, I perish. I have to do what I have to do. The realization for Esther that God was working through her. And you know she had to have a little smugness. I mean, you can't just be made queen of Persia without being a little proud of yourself. You know, that's just the way it is. But then all of a sudden you're like, oh, it's up to me to save everybody. And what made her go from that I don't want to do it to, if if I die, I die. I'll go before the king and I'll do what I need to do. And you're not going to hear the rest of the story till next week. But, but think about this. Like Esther, we have been made for specific times and places. Think about this. We did not select our birthday. We didn't select our family. We didn't select the generation or the neighborhood or the country where we were born into. We didn't select any of that. We had no control over that. So why are we here? I'll think, have you ever wondered about that? I wonder if my mom would have actually married this again. Because I will tell you a quick little story. Mom was actually engaged to somebody else before dad and they broke up. Okay? So I often, would I be here? If they got, would I even be here? Because dad wouldn't have been in the picture. So how, I wouldn't be here because this was dad's church. Okay? The other guy was from Delta. I had to be a wildcat. But, you know, how would that have changed everything? We don't select the way our parents meet. And that's been one of the draws of the movie Back to the Future, why it's so great a movie, is you see, you know, what could happen here. We don't select our birth date. We didn't pick who we were born to, or when we were born, or how we were born. But you know what? God makes sure that each of our lives intersect together for opportunities to advance his kingdom. And that's why we're here. And that's why we're in specific places and times. And that's why this church is here. Because at one time somebody saw a need, and I still believe God is still working, and he's still talking, and he's still working through us, or we wouldn't be here. We may not understand God's providence, but it is still working. And keep that in mind. Amen. And if you would open your hymnals to 446. And I will tell you, this is a hymn I had never heard until I went to the Presbyterian Church in Potosi when I thought up there. And I liked it. Anybody else like to hear the story to tell the nursing? It's different. Stand with me, please. It's not an easy one to sing necessarily, but it's not fun.
We've a story to tell to the nations that shall turn.
Save us, his son, to save.
keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Amen.
Yeah. 58 minutes long.